Good afternoon, and may it please the court. I'm Anthony Shelley here on behalf of the ERISA Industry Committee, also known as ERIC, and I would like to reserve 3 minutes of my time for rebuttal. I plan to focus initially and primarily here on the first argument we presented in our brief. There have been several arguments that ERIC has presented, alternative arguments as to why this is the Seattle ordinance is preempted, but I'd like to initially focus on the first argument, and that is that there is preemption because each of the three options in the Seattle ordinance requires the establishment or maintenance of an ERISA plan. On this first argument, the dispute is really over whether the first option, the direct payment option, constitutes an ERISA plan, and it does, in our view, constitute an ERISA plan for two reasons. Because the direct payment is a benefit under ERISA, it's not wages, and because an employer needs a plan to administer that benefit. On the issue of whether the direct payment is a benefit, the city says no, it is not, and the district court said it wasn't as well, because the money supposedly is just wages. But the ordinance itself says that these monies under the direct payment option are not wages, and that's in section 14.28.060.E. And the amount of the direct payment rises or falls with medical inflation, which wages usually don't.
Was there direct payment in Golden Gate?
There was not a direct payment to an employee in Golden Gate, and that's one of the chief reasons to distinguish Golden Gate. The payment instead was to the city of San Francisco to provide health care to low-income workers, as opposed to, in this case,
I'm looking at page 644 of Golden Gate. It looks like it was like the plan included contributions to a health savings account, reimbursement for to covered employees for expenses, and payments to a covered employer to a third party. And then fourth would be costs incurred by a covered employer in the direct delivery of health care. None of those qualify as direct payments.
The first three do, the fourth does not. And in Golden Gate, what the court said was because that fourth option did not constitute an ERISA plan, the whole statute survives ERISA preemption. Our point here in this argument is that if you're going to take the Golden Gate paradigm and say that so long as there's one option that is not an ERISA plan, you therefore don't have preemption, that paradigm doesn't apply because under every option here, you have an ERISA plan. And so the key comparison then is whether the Golden Gate payment to the city option, whether that's close enough to the direct-to-employee payment option under the Seattle statute to also not be an ERISA plan. And our point is it's not. It's entirely different. And in fact, I think Golden Gate would have come out differently if it had four options, the first three of which were ERISA plans, and the fourth option was a direct-to-employee payment that worked like this one. And the reason that this isn't wages like it was in that under that fourth option in Golden Gate is because it varies also based on the size of the individual's family and based on whether the individual has a spouse or partner. Wages don't do that. They don't vary based on the family size. And in Golden Gate, under that fourth option, Judge Bybee, that you mentioned, the amount to the city only varied with the number of hours that were worked, which is almost akin to a wage.
Why should that make a difference?
It makes a difference.
In other words, when I say that, I mean, that the amount of the payment can vary.
Because that then goes to the second element. Once you have a benefit that's not wages, for there to be an ERISA plan, it has to be necessary that the employer must establish an administrative process. The variance is what requires the administrative process. In this situation, the employer is forced to go out in order to make the direct payment to the employee, has to go out and reasonably investigate the individual's family situation, spousal and partner situation. That requires an administrative thing to do. Pardon me?
Why is that? Why is that? Why can't the employer do the same thing they do for, when an employee files a tax exemption form? List your spouse, list your defense, and so forth.
That's not required.
That's all they have to do, right?
That's not required, I don't believe, on the tax form. The tax form, a W-2 form, for instance, I believe only requires that the individual list how many dependents they want to claim. And it might not be exactly equal to what they actually have in their household, for instance, because the withholding amount, they want to vary the withholding amount based on certain conditions. But the important thing is the comparison to Golden Gate. That Golden Gate varied the payments to the city solely on the basis of an aggregate of how many workers do you have and how many hours in total do they work. Here, the employer has to set up an administrative scheme to make a payment to each individual employee, not an aggregate to the state, but at each individual employee, and has to then determine for each individual employee exactly what level of benefits they're entitled to. Additionally, there's an intricate waiver process associated with this first option. If the employer presents the option of coverage and the employee doesn't accept that option, then the employer has to provide the direct payment, but has to memorialize the entire process of offering the other type of coverage. All these things were non-existent in Golden Gate. And as a result, Golden Gate is a different case. Instead, this option is very much close to what the court considered in the Aloha Airlines case, which is another precedent we cited. The Aloha Airlines case involved a Hawaii wage law. Yes, a wage law, in fact, on its terms, that required airline employers to provide money to pilot employees to cover the cost of certain physicals. The court said that the money was benefits, and the program the employer had to establish was sufficiently intricate to constitute an ERISA plan. The program there, unlike here, was a the program in Aloha Airlines, like here, but unlike in Golden Gate, was a direct employer to employee payment plan. The payment turned merely on whether the pilot was a Class A pilot or Class B pilot, in the sense of did they have a requirement for a physical. That was the only requirement, but nonetheless, the court said that was a sufficiently intricate determination, a benefits eligibility determination, to constitute the need for an administrative scheme for an ERISA plan. And that's very much like...
Aloha is, I'm sure you know, come under criticism as perhaps a no longer viable law. What is your reaction to that criticism?
I disagree entirely because on this aspect of Aloha Airlines, it's not been criticized. It's not been criticized on the point of whether or not the requirement of a payment of the type that was in Aloha Airlines could constitute an ERISA plan. I think it's drawn criticism for some other aspects of the case. Moreover, the cases on which this whole issue relies are earlier. It's Fort Halifax and Marash, which were earlier than Aloha Airlines. The cases that come after Aloha Airlines in the ERISA preemption world, for instance, don't have to do with this issue as to whether a administrative scheme is sufficiently intricate to constitute an ERISA plan. So I would say Aloha Airlines is fully governing. In fact, I think it was just cited a year last year in a case we cite in our briefs by a district court within this circuit. It was cited by this circuit earlier in the 2000s for an ERISA point. So I believe it remains good law. So the decision we would say the court should rely on is Aloha Airlines. And on this particular issue, the Golden Gate case is distinguishable. I'd also like to point out a third case that the court has decided. Back when ERISA first started, the court decided Standard Oil Company versus Exelund, which was then affirmed summarily by the U.S. Supreme Court. And in that case, the court was asked to determine whether another Hawaii statute that required a health insurance plan that basically the employer enroll individuals in health insurance, whether that constituted an ERISA plan. And what the court held was that it did, and that the Hawaii statute was preempted. And in response, the state of Hawaii asserted that it wasn't preempted because of another instance in which a Rhode Island statute wasn't preempted. And this is what Hawaii said. Hawaii urges that there is an inconsistency in holding that the Hawaii Act is preempted by ERISA when another scheme, the Rhode Island Catastrophic Insurance Plan, is not preempted. The Rhode Island statute differs from the Hawaii statute in that the Rhode Island statute is not based on the employer-employee relationship common to ERISA and the Hawaii Act. The Rhode Island statute envisions a state-administered fund rather than funds established or maintained by employers. The Hawaii plan and the Rhode Island plan are distinguishable insofar as they may be affected by ERISA. So that distinction is one the court has already noted and must follow because it was in its own precedent, of course, and affirmed by the U.S. Supreme Court, and it makes it different from Golden Gate. The next argument I'd like to push to is that Golden Gate, even if you, on a different theory, actually fully supports preemption in a different way. Golden Gate says at the very end of the opinion that Judge Fletcher wrote, says that where a statute sets up options, one of which is non-ERISA option for this purpose, I'll assume moving on to an alternative argument that the first option is not an ERISA option, but only for purposes of this argument. If there is a non-ERISA option, that non-ERISA option can save the statute from preemption only if it's a meaningful option. If it's not one, as the court put it, that in practical effect the employer would choose, it's not meaningful and shouldn't be considered. Because and it also noted that the court also asked, would a rational employer choose that option, or alternatively, does it have an irresistible incentive to provide its employees with a greater level of health benefits? We've argued, we in our complaint in this case, we pled that this was not, that the direct payment option, even if it's a non-ERISA option, was not a meaningful remedy. And that's because with it, unlike the other options, comes an employment tax obligation for the employer, an employment tax obligation for the employee, an income tax obligation for the employee. There's no assurance that the employee will use the money for his or her health benefits. And in addition, the employer, if it goes with the direct payment option, is going to have to set up an administrative scheme anyway, in addition to the ERISA plan it already has. So no reasonable employer would accept this option. The district court rejected it, saying we had to show evidence, but this was on a 12B6 stage, and our allegations are plausible on their face. In fact, no employer has accepted the direct payment option. They've all shown, they've all, as we allege in our complaint, gone with the other options. So I'd like to, if there are no questions, further questions, I'd like to reserve the remainder of my time.
All right, counsel.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, and may it please the court. Jeremiah Miller, Assistant City Attorney for the City of Seattle. I think the most important thing for this court to consider in resolving this issue is how the ordinance actually functions. As counsel has suggested, the ordinance comes with an obligation for employers to pay money to or on behalf of employees. The employer can fully satisfy that payment obligation by making regular wage-like payments to employees. This is critical in relation to the point that counsel was making about whether or not Aloha Airlines would require a different outcome here. Although briefly mentioned, the real key to this question are the cases, the Supreme Court cases in Morash and Fort Halifax. There, the Supreme Court specifically approved payments to employees for severance benefits in the case of Fort Halifax and for vacation payments in the case of Morash. Morash, the court recognized that those vacation benefits were a type of benefit that could create a plan under some circumstances, but they held that a regular wage-like payment of vacation benefits simply didn't implicate the concerns that ERISA was intended to address. That is, that there was no more danger of defeated expectations by the employees that they would receive those benefits than for regular wages. And that is precisely the situation here. The ordinance requires that employers pay every covered employee a fixed amount of money every month, set by statute, not by reference to any benefit or anything external. The employer is required to obtain and record general employment information. Character of these payments is really clear from the way that they're laid out as regular monthly recurring payments. Under that understanding of the individual direct payments, there can be no question that paying money to employees constitutes an ERISA plan. As a matter of fact, this sort of invitation would call into question other decisions of this court surrounding payment of minimum wage that had wage variations based on ERISA plans, like International Franchise Association. The other point that I think is important for this court to consider is the degree to which Golden Gate simply controls and compels the outcome here, as the district court determined. The structure of these two ordinances is that the ordinance that's before the court today and the San Francisco ordinance are indistinguishable in their particulars. The San Francisco ordinance requires payments to or on behalf of employees. It sets the rate by normal employment conditions.
What about Mr. Shelley's distinction that we get it right? Golden Gate really does not have a direct payment option.
Yes, Your Honor, that's correct, that the San Francisco ordinance does not have a direct payment option of the same sort as the ordinance in Seattle. But the reasoning that this court used to arrive at finding that direct pay or finding the payment to the San Francisco healthcare plan to be not preempted by ERISA was precisely the Morash and Fort Halifax argument I began with.
Wait a minute, which option is that? The payment to the city?
Yes, under San Francisco's healthcare ordinance, there was a direct payment to a city healthcare plan. And it's in analyzing that that this court said, well, expanding the principles in Morash that have to do with regular wage-like payments, those are not an ERISA plan. The same logic which remains in effect today compels the conclusion that the Seattle ordinance's obligation to pay money directly to employees is also not an ERISA plan. So because Golden Gate controls the outcome of this case, the district court correctly dismissed the underlying complaint. As I was saying, the ordinance structures are the same. They both have non-ERISA options within them. They have similar kinds of record-keeping requirements. Council made some references to a waiver program. There's a similar waiver provision in the San Francisco ordinance. Those waivers under the San Francisco ordinance are required to be voluntary, which would require some information. Waivers of wages owed or payments like that are not uncommon in state law. They're common in the state of Washington, several places where deductions from wages have to be recorded. And then there has been no intervening change in the law that would suggest that Golden Gate isn't simply binding precedent in this circuit. Given those two, given that the case is there's no factual distinction between the two ordinances, and that the law has remained good, the outcome has to be that the ordinance is not preempted by ERISA. But even to the extent that Golden Gate no longer applied or was distinguishable on its facts, it was built on absolutely settled Supreme Court precedent that was even just recently reaffirmed by the Supreme Court in the Rutledge case. Golden Gate's central conclusions were driven by the trilogy of Travelers, Dillingham, and DuBuono. And those three cases laid out the modern ERISA jurisprudence, including the tests that are used under the relate to language of the preemption clause. That is that only laws that either make an impermissible reference to or have an impermissible connection with ERISA plans are actually preempted. And in this case, there could be no question that there is no reference to an ERISA plan. For that to be true, there would have to be, the law would have to immediately and exclusively act upon ERISA plans, which it does not, or ERISA plans would have to be essential to its operations. As I've said, the first option, direct cash payments to employees, is not an ERISA plan, so the law is fully functional in the absence of any ERISA plan. This is similarly the case for the connection with prong. There you would need a ordinance that was so structured that it dictated certain plan choices or bound plan administrators to a certain outcome. I think it's really critical to understand that this ordinance applies only to employers and employees. To the extent that it has some tangential impact on choices plans make, that's really the distant relationship that was specifically approved in cases like Dillingham, Rutledge, and Travelers, where changes in the cost that might be felt by the plans just simply aren't enough to lead to preemption. And related to this two-pronged test, which is the modern ERISA jurisprudence, council's reliance on Aloha is particularly misplaced. So council claims to be citing Aloha only for the purpose of establishing what constitutes an ERISA plan. But the case has to be read as a whole, and it reached the conclusion that the state law under analysis there was preempted using a four-part test, which is no longer current. And in fact, turning on things like that it required varying payments at varying times, which is not a feature of this ordinance. That was one of the elements in Aloha. Also that it required a specific medical benefit. I mean, the Aloha case had a state law where they were paying for a very specific medical exam that the FAA had mandated for pilots. Here, you're talking about, again, payments of money that don't have to be used for anything in particular. So like I said, Aloha should not drive this court's decision in this case. You know, in the end, this is absolutely the sort of case where you've got an ordinance that is fully functional in the absence of any ERISA plan. It's about regulating the relationship between employers and employees, not about regulating plan administration or requiring plans to do anything. There really is no reason to look at the scope of laws that Congress thought would survive and find an ordinance like this one that is so clearly within the traditional authorities of this of the city to protect the safety and health of its workers, and find that it should have been preempted, particularly not since the Supreme Court has retreated from the admittedly impossible to interpret or enforce relate to language that's in the preemption clause. And then I guess the last thing I'd like to address is council's suggestion that the costs imposed by this ordinance were so acute that they caused or that they should be a basis for preemption. The first thing I'd like to point out on that subject is that the ordinance requires the payment of a set amount of money. And that set amount of money does not vary by the option that's selected. So simply on its face, the ordinance does not require employers to spend more or less money if they choose an ERISA method or a non-ERISA method for coverage. But in addition to that, you know, although this language about economic effects being sufficient or possibly sufficient has been repeated by the Supreme Court for years, we're unaware, and as far as we can tell, there are no cases that actually apply that as a means of establishing ERISA preemption. This is particularly telling in cases like Travelers, Dillingham, and also Rutledge, where the Supreme Court there doesn't even engage in discussions about the facts of the actual costs. There doesn't appear to be an issue with the amount of money it was costing plans to comply, but rather they say, when you make changes that affect the shopping decisions of a plan, they're not enough. So again, the district court here was correct to dismiss this complaint under the controlling precedent of Golden Gate and the Supreme Court cases that underlie it, like Travelers, Dillingham, De Bono, which were recently reaffirmed in Rutledge. If there are no further questions, I believe I've covered all the points I would like to.
All right, thank you, counsel. Rebuttal.
Thank you, Your Honor. I'd just like to make a few points. First of all, Mr. Miller repeated several times, and really the basis of the argument is that the payments under the direct payment option are just wage-like. Was the term he used. They can't be wages. They can't be wage-like because they vary based on the size of the family and the marital status of the individual. Not even health need. It's just the marital status of the individual. Under Washington law, wages that differentiate based on marital status are illegal. They're discriminatory against those who aren't married. So they aren't wage-like.
I got the point that they're not wage-like, and I understand the distinction. So tell me why that makes a difference here if they're still direct payments.
They are direct payments, but the distinction is that you have to set up a separate system from wages in order to administer the payments. You can't just, you know, they aren't just an add-on to wages that are already there. You have to have an entirely different system to administer the direct payment here. You have to reasonably investigate each individual employee's circumstances to determine whether they're entitled to the rate for a single person, a married person, a person with a partner, a person with dependents, whether they're children or others living in your house. This is the key, that an administrative scheme the employer has to create is what makes for an ERISA plan. Mr. Miller relied on Fort Halifax, but Fort Halifax on this point has a very helpful discussion for us. And this is at page 12 of the Fort Halifax decision, where the court says why the direct payment there was not an ERISA plan. And the court said the requirement of a one-time lump sum payment triggered by a single event requires no administrative scheme whatsoever to meet the employer's obligations. The employer assumes no responsibility to pay benefits on a regular basis and thus faces no periodic demands on its assets that create a need for financial coordination and control. This isn't a one-time lump sum payment equal for everybody in this case. This is a monthly recurring payment that will vary depending on whether the person is married, has a partner, has family members, whether more dependents enter the house, the employee has a baby. All those things change, and it changes every single month. In addition, there's the whole waiver process that is completely different from the San Francisco ordinance and not at all present in Fort Halifax. The last point I'd like to make is that Mr. Miller suggested that Golden Gate does, in its reasoning, indicate that if it were a direct payment option there as to the employee as opposed to the city, that there still would have been preemption. But tying the two exactly together is impossible given the Standard Oil versus Absolute case, which I cited earlier and spoke from earlier, because it draws a severe distinction between the two. And in any event, the Golden Gate San Francisco ordinance was just a tag on to wages as opposed to what we have here. So we would ask that the court reverse what the district court did. This case, this statute is preempted.
All right, thank you, counsel. Thank you to both counsel. The case just argued is submitted for decision by the court. That completes our calendar for today. We are in recess until 1:00 p.m. tomorrow.